Good evening, friends. Welcome to one more CME of Academy of Advanced Medical Education. I am Mangesh Tiwaskar. I am the General Secretary of Association of Physicians, but more importantly, I am a Joint Secretary of the Academy of Advanced Medical Education. Today, we have got a very special CME for you. Now, today's CME is brought to you primarily by Academy of Advanced Medical Education, an academy which was inspired by Professor Dr. K.C. Mohanty sir, who was not only our mentor, but he also had a dream that we should have some way by which we can decipher and decipher knowledge at the most remotest possible of the country to all the deserving and willing to learn healthcare professionals, especially the doctors, those who are interested in learning. So today is our 42nd CME of Academy of Advanced Medical Education. I thank you all once again on this very special moment. And this CME is going to be very special. Why it is going to be very special? Because for the first time, a web CME would be officially inaugurated by one of the stalwarts of the medical community. And secondly, that everybody will get a participation certificate from the Academy of Advanced Medical Education. And thirdly, is this that we'll be breaking up for the Prime Minister's speech, as this was a last minute development today. So we'll break up for the Prime Minister's speech. And on the same platform, we'll be streaming Prime Minister's speech as a mark of honor to our Honorable Prime Minister. We'll be telecasting Prime Minister's speech on the same platform, so you don't have to log off. And you can listen, and then we'll continue our discussion. And to join in this discussion, we have got one of the legends of cardiology in the country. I'll not be disclosing the name right now. As we progress, I'll be letting you know. So once again, I welcome you all for this educational venture from Academy of Advanced Medical Education. So I would officially request Dr. Muruganathan. Dr. Muruganathan, sir, is not only our mentor, he was a past president of Association of Physicians of India, a governor of American College of Physicians India chapter. But Dr. Muruganathan is better known for his ability to decipher the education in the most needy areas for the most needy population. I request Dr. Muruganathan to inaugurate officially this CME or this webcast on pulmonary hypertension. Over to you, Muruganathan sir.
Thank you, Dr. Mangesh Tiwaskar, my dear brother, and I'm very happy. A lot of my good friends and brothers are here. Dr. Ketan Mehta, Dr. Agam Vora, and my beloved friend, forgotten friend, our brother, Udit Singh Wander, and my dear brothers and sisters. At the outset, I have to pay my respect and also salute the COVID warriors who have sacrificed their life. I also bow my head to all those people who are in the COVID battle day and night, trying to save our world from COVID. Today is a special day. This is called World Nurses Day, International Nurses Day. So nursing the world to health, that is the theme. So we dedicate this program for the dedicated nurses also. So this is an auspicious day, as Mangesh said. Prime Minister is going to speak. But only thing I wish I should have some opportunity to interact with the Prime Minister. Only, you know, I can see, listen to him, not interact with him. And the Advanced Academy of Medical Education is a very good academy. I know for the last 8 years under the presidentship of Mehanty, they were doing. And I was lucky and fortunate enough to participate in 3-4 academy. They consider me as only chief guest, but not as a faculty, because they thought I'm not a good academician. So I'm like a politician, no? I come and inaugurate and go, because they think my depth of knowledge is not so good as Wander. So they always ask me to inaugurate only and then say, get out. And once at least they took me to Bangkok. I don't know whether they still remember. And Bangkok also, they came, I mean, they took me, but you know, all these trustees, Milind Natkar, Ketan Mehta, and Mangesh, they disappeared in Bangkok. They left me in the room. So I still remember those, you know, interesting aspects of the Academy of Advanced Education. They're doing a lot of good program. Today, the topic pulmonary hypertension is a very important subject, interesting subject, but often neglected subject. In this COVID times, the pulmonary hypertension becomes very important. You know why? Any COVID patient, they can develop pulmonary hypertension. How? One, because of the lung injury. Second, because of microvascular thrombosis. Third, because of the myocarditis and heart failure. And fourth, through hypoxia. So these four, five mechanisms, you know, I think the stalwart's going to explain what is the pathogenesis of pulmonary hypertension. So these four mechanisms can bring pulmonary hypertension as a bigger problem in the COVID times also. Pulmonary hypertension is a very complex, multifactorial disease from way back 1800. A lot of confusions in the evaluation, diagnosis, treatment, diagnostic tools, etc. And I can simply say it can be two eras. One is before the right cardiac catheterization, and second is after the cardiac catheterization. You know, that's a division. And some people say it is pre-sclerotic and then, two classifications. One is the Paulwood has given three classifications. And then some people have said primary hypertension and primary pulmonary hypertension, secondary pulmonary hypertension. There are a lot of discussion. And finally, the WHO has pinpointed and then given five classifications. Pre-capillary and post-capillary, So early detection of pulmonary hypertension is the key. Somebody comes with you with breathlessness, it is always better to evaluate, especially you should do echo. Because echo, our wanderer will going to explain, echo will give you immediate diagnosis. So if you detect early, it's good. Recently, I saw one article, even if the patient has got, mean arterial pressure of 20, 21 or 20, you know, they are more prone to develop problems. So we early detect, and then not only early detect, find out the cause. As I said, there will be 5-6 classification. If you find the cause, you can definitely do the control. Again, pulmonary hypertension is very interesting because clinically, when we were students, you know, pulmonary hypertension did not have imaging, did not have serological marker and exercise, things like that. So we used to do only clinical when the P2 is low. And sometimes closed split or fixed split or reversible split. And there is a murmur called Gram-Still murmur. My chief used to tell me, you know, what is Gram-Still murmur? What Gram-Still said about the murmur? He said soft, blowing, descendo, early diastolic murmur, which you can only listen, especially after my long, lengthy rounds when it's silent. This is what he said. Only then you can listen to the murmur. But now we don't do lengthy rounds. Neither we do silent wall rounds. So we cannot hear the round, murmur, unless we are tuned to it. And people, experts like Wander can hear the murmur. So the key, I said, is early detection. For that, there are so many tools are there. And today, our experts are going to talk about the management, the pathophysiology of pulmonary hypertension. I'll have just quick 10 top pulmonary stories of pulmonary hypertension in the last 12 months. Antibody able to block protein that promotes pulmonary hypertension may bolster existing therapy, one of the studies. The other study says Astilan needs further studies on obstetric treatment for inoperable pulmonary hypertension. Then eudenophil can increase exercise capacity. Long-term adenovirus treatment may reverse right heart failure in pulmonary hypertension. United Therapies gains global rights to protein therapy. High cardiac troponin, because the more troponin, the mortality is more. Even in the COVID, if somebody has got troponin more, 10 times more mortality. Then Opsumit has potential improved right ventricular function. And most study finds causal link between iron levels and pulmonary hypertension, because they find more of iron anemia in the pulmonary hypertension. That's another study links pulmonary artery pressure greater than 30 millimeter to increase mortality. Then just released the recent updated guidelines. I think these are the 10 top stories of pulmonary hypertension which I could gather. I didn't want to, you know, take full stories because I leave to the experts who will explain better. So I'm again, once again, thankful to the organizers, especially my friends and brothers, who asked me to inaugurate. And during the academic activity, Dr. Agambora said, you also be a panel member. And I said, I can be a panel member, but I won't be able to answer many questions. But if none of you can answer, then I will answer. Because that is my strength. Now, when there is a question like that, when Wander cannot answer, when Agambora cannot answer, Mangesh cannot answer, I can answer. I speak English. So then, you know, I'll make sure that, you know, people really get complicated by my answer and they will not ask again. That's the way I answer the questions. So with this, I have great pleasure in inaugurating the conference in the traditional way, in the traditional way, which I'm going to light the lamp in front of you. And I request Wander and every faculty to join me in inaugurating, in lighting the lamp. Can you see the lamp, please?
Yes.
Yes, sir. So yes, please, sir, join me. Yes, sir. We can see the lamp. But this is the first time a webinar. You know, yesterday we had a webinar marriage, in the video marriage. Now we are having the webinar inauguration. I think everybody is clear about the. So I think first time we are doing an inauguration. This only thing I miss your memento and shawl. Of course, you can send it to me by courier. So a lot of people are clapping also. You see that? Yes. Okay. With this, now I hand over to my brother moderator, Mangesh. I'll come back if there is a need for it. Thank you, Mangesh. Thank you, Wander. Thank you, Ketan, and thank you, Agam. And I thank the guidance also for, you know, inviting me for it.
Thank you so much, Murugnathan, sir. That was awesome. In fact, we all will agree that is what Murugnathan, sir's effect is. Friends, this program is brought to you with the educational support from Zydus Fortiza. So I would like to thank entire Zydus team. Samir is already here. I believe Praveen is also there. So, and the entire team, because, you know, today being lockdown period, we understand that it's so difficult for all of you guys to do such a groundwork, send invites. So that tells us that you are really worked very, very hard. Mm-hmm. And as Dr. Murugnathan has said, that we dedicate this entire CME to the staff nurses, because we know that, you know, being doctors, we know the disease, but being staff nurses, they not only know the disease, but they know a human being who is suffering from the disease. They spend a lot more time with the patients than we doctors or the consultants they do. So with this, I would request now Dr. Agambora, who is a secretary of Academy of Advanced Medical Education, to take a general overview of pulmonary hypertension. Now, to talk about Agam, it makes me really very, very proud to say that Agam is not only my friend, but he is my soulmate, he is my advisor, he is my mentor, he is my teacher, and not only that, he is a very, very close associate. Not a day passes since last 22 years that I have not spoken to Agam on an everyday basis. It's been an honor to introduce you, all of you, to Dr. Professor Dr. Agambora. He is a guiding force behind managing all the CMEs. And I hand him over to talk about the pulmonary hypertension and an overview of pulmonary hypertension. Over to Agam. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Mangesh Srivastava. So everybody here now knows Mangesh is a very close friend. We have decided to introduce each other in a special way, you know, make both of us. So I owe this to you, Mangesh. Next introduction, I will also say very, very nice things about you. Thank you, Dr. Murugnathan. That was an excellent way of inaugurating the conference. We thought we would do something new, but then you've really amazed all of us by actually lightening the lamp and your Shall also Academy, you know, probably, you know, it's on us. We would next time for sure when we meet, you would deserve that shawl, and we would be very happy to offer a small token of our appreciation or love to you, and would seek your blessings. I'm so happy Ketan is there. I'm so happy Dr. Samir Muchale is there. I'm so happy Dr. Wonder is here. Dr. Wonder has spared his invaluable time to be with us. So this program is unique in various ways. We have already about 1,000 plus delegates already online listening to our program, and we will have probably next 35 to 40 minutes on the discussion of pulmonary hypertension, and then we would take a small break to listen to our honorable Prime Minister. He will be addressing us, and after that discussion we would have question and answer session by Dr. Ketan Mehta, and he is going to present few cases. Dr. Murugnathan has spoken about those nurses special days, and nurses play various role at various phases of your life. And me and Mangesh were just talking about the vital role nurses play during our undergraduate days, and those rose days and those eclair days that we shared with them. And then as you grow, you really require their help in patient management as well. So probably, you know, your expectations from nurses change as per the timeline. Without wasting much of time, I would probably talk about pulmonary hypertension. And pulmonary hypertension means increased blood pressure of the pulmonary vasculature. In the pulmonary circulation, it may be only in the arteries, that is pulmonary arterial hypertension, or it may be both in the veins or in the arteries. It is not a single disease or a diagnosis, but it is caused by variety of disorders. So you have a group of heterogeneous disorders presenting with same physiological defect at the vasculature, which increases the pulmonary vascular resistance, leading to right-sided ventricular failure and then premature death. Hemodynamically, it is defined as increase in mean pulmonary artery pressure of about 25 at rest or about 30 during exercises. The normal pressure could be about 20 at rest and about 25 on exercises. And when you look at the arterial abnormalities, there is intimal hyperplasia, there is medial hypertrophy, adventitial proliferation, thrombosis, various degree of inflammation, and this is what I was talking to you about. You have even, you also have the plexiform lesion, as it can be seen on the side. This is also the part of disease process. And when disease goes to that, you have thrombosis there, you have adventitial intimal proliferation and smooth muscle hypertrophy. Probably disease at that stage is irreversible. And hence beauty is to pick up disease at this stage when it is still in the reversible phase and probably change the course of illness. The pulmonary hypertension is actually a general term used to describe elevated pressure in the pulmonary vascular bed, but it does not describe where the lesion is. Whereas pulmonary arterial hypertension is a subset of pulmonary hypertension. It is one of the causes of pulmonary hypertension, where it describes that elevated pressure in the pulmonary vasculature is limited to arteries and arterioles, and it is due to an intrinsic abnormality of the pulmonary arterial floor, the arterial bed. So this is pulmonary hypertension. Pulmonary hypertension would mean pulmonary artery pressure of more than 25. So equal to more than 25 would be pulmonary arterial hypertension. If it is precapillary, then your pulmonary wedge pressure would be less than 15. So whenever your pulmonary wedge pressure is less than 15 with pulmonary artery pressure more than 25, you are talking about precapillary. And precapillary would mean either arterial hypertension, it would mean either due to thromboembolic phenomena or due to lung disease. But whenever your pulmonary wedge pressure is high, that means whenever it is above 15, it is due to left-sided heart disease. So this is based on the hemodynamic definition. This is how you would divide pulmonary hypertension into precapillary and postcapillary. Postcapillary is generally due to cardiac disorders, and precapillary could be due to lung causes or thromboembolic or primary arterial hypertension. The causes could be vasoconstriction, there could be remodeling, there could be inflammation and associated thrombosis. Pathophysiology, it is affected by NO, that is nitric oxide pathway, endothelial pathway, that is endothelial dysfunction, or the prostacyclin pathway. So there are three pathways actually working. It may give you inflammation there, there may be coagulation disorders, and this is what it leads to. There are changes in adventitia, there are changes in media, endothelium and blood, including the intimal changes. So whenever there is blood showing hypercoagulability, there may be a role for anticoagulation. Whenever you see endothelial dysfunction, there is a role for endothelin receptor antagonist, phosphodiesterase inhibitors, or prostanoids. And whenever there is issues with the potassium channel, you could think of calcium channel blockers, and probably they may have its role to play. So this is the overview of three pathways where you could have predominantly endothelin pathways, nitric oxide pathway, or the prostacyclin pathway leading to imbalance of the vasoactive substances with nitric oxide, prostaglandin, thromboxane on one end, impaired. On the other hand, probably there is vasoconstriction due to resistance to endothelin and thromboxane A2. Initially, we were looking at pulmonary hypertension in two ways. One is primary, where the cause is not known, and secondary due to some other causes. But currently, for last 1.5 decades, we are looking at pulmonary hypertension based on this newer WHO classification. It divides pulmonary hypertension into 5 different categories. So class 1 is pulmonary arterial hypertension, where you have so many diseases included, where it is idiopathic, where you have no causes found. It could be familial. It could be associated with connective tissue disorder. We commonly see with scleroderma, connected with congenital systemic to pulmonary shunts. There could be portal hypertension and association with it. In HIV individuals, for unknown reasons, you have pulmonary arterial hypertension. So many drugs and toxins could also lead to pulmonary arterial hypertension. It could also be part of thyroid disorder. It may be associated with significant venous or capillary involvement. You may also have veno-occlusive diseases. Group 2 or class 2 is pulmonary hypertension secondary to left heart disease. So you have a left-sided atrial or ventricular heart disease, or you have a left-sided valvular heart disease. It could lead to pulmonary hypertension. Group 3 is pulmonary hypertension that a pulmonologist would see, that is associated with underlying lung disease or underlying hypoxia as the cause. We commonly see hypoxia with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, that's COPD, interstitial lung disease. You may have a variety of alveolar hypoventilation syndromes. Chronic high altitude, people who are living at a high altitude may have chronic hypoxia and pulmonary hypertension due to that. And one other common cause is obstructive sleep apnea, that is sleep disordered breathing, giving rise to pulmonary hypertension. Then the next important category, something that we tend to underdiagnose, but one of the common etiologies, and that is pulmonary hypertension due to chronic thromboembolic disease. This is chronic thromboembolism, not the acute one. So you have a thromboembolic obstruction proximal to pulmonary arteries, or you may have it distal to pulmonary arteries. Both could give you that. And in few situations, it could be non-thrombotic because of the tumor or the parasites, the foreign material pressing on the pulmonary vasculature, you could get it. And then there are some miscellaneous causes like sarcoidosis, lymphangioleomyomatosis, histocytosis giving rise to pulmonary hypertension. And hence, we now look at pulmonary hypertension not as conventionally we used to see with primary and secondary, but now we look at 5. One is pulmonary arterial hypertension. Second is pulmonary hypertension secondary to heart disease, left-sided. Third is pulmonary hypertension secondary to lung disease, that is hypoxia. Fourth is chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, and fifth is miscellaneous. This is the functional classification of pulmonary hypertension, and this is important to decide a treatment plan for this patient. And you have a class 1 where patient has pulmonary hypertension, but patient is not symptomatic. That means it does not result into limitation of physical activities. Ordinary activity is very well able to do. There is no dyspnea, no fatigue, no chest pain, or no syncope. Class 2 is it results into slight limitation of activity. That means they are absolutely comfortable at rest. They are able to do their activities, but they are a little symptomatic during those activities. Class 3 is there is limitation of activity. They are not comfortable during their activities. They are even though they are comfortable at rest, but then minimal activity would lead to symptoms of dyspnea, fatigue, chest pain, or syncope. And class 4 is patient with significant disability. In the sense, these patients may manifest signs of right-sided heart failure. They are dyspneic and fatigue even at rest. They are in discomfort even when they are in the state of rest. Initially, we thought it is a rare disease, not very common. But trust me, person of more than 50 years of age, and I'm sure Dr. Wander is going to vouch for it, patient has core pulmonale, and consequences of untreated pulmonary hypertension is the third most common cardiac disease. After coronary and hypertensive heart disease, if you look at other disease, this is the third most common cause of chronic heart disease. Idiopathic pulmonary hypertension is a part of pulmonary hypertension. Females suffer slightly more than male. The usual age of presentation is about 40 years, but you may get this during their first pregnancy. Many patients may present with pulmonary hypertension during pregnancy and they may miscarriage. This data says that probably 15 per million is pulmonary arterial hypertension, and idiopathic could be 6 per million. And there is some hereditary transmission, and also you can see familial pulmonary hypertension, about 6 to 10% of the patients may have running in their family of the pulmonary hypertension group. Probably prognosis is poor. You lose a lot of patients there. Probably in 1 year, you may lose probably, you know, 30% of the patients, and by the end of fifth year, probably you would have lost about 70% of your patients. And this is probably, you know, the graph where in the initial part, patients are completely asymptomatic. And probably, you know, once they start developing symptoms, the cardiac output falls dramatically after that, and probably they go into soon decompensation and right-sided dysfunction. And the presentation is generally non-specific, develops very slowly. And they label it to probably underlying condition, they may label it to smoking, they may label it to various other things. But generally dyspnea, particularly on activity, is the most common presenting feature. You may have fatigue presenting, syncope in about 13% of the patient, chest pain, palpitation, and leg edema could be there in small number of patients. When would you suspect? You will keep very high index of suspicion whenever you have disproportional breathlessness. So you have a patient of, say, hypertensive heart, but he is disproportionately breathless, you would think about pulmonary hypertension. You have a patient of lung disease, you know patient is a COPD, but then his breathlessness is disproportionate to the kind of illness he has. You have done his spirometry, you have looked at the degree of obstruction, and probably if the breathlessness does not match with that, probably suspect pulmonary hypertension. Whenever a patient is complaining of fatigue, syncope, chest pain, near syncope, palpitation, leg edema, and when you have done the workup and you can't find other causes, keep this particular thing as one of the possibility. Especially when you are dealing with a cirrhotic patient, patient of connective tissue disorder, patient with hemoglobinopathies, or patients of patient of retroviral disease, that is HIV patient, do keep this in mind. This slide is a very complex slide, but look at whenever you suspect, this is the flow I would recommend. You first look at the blue colored part. You know, you have history, examination, simple X-ray chest and ECG would raise the index of suspicion. That means you have a particular patient, say you have a patient of COPD. And when you do this, you probably would look at, oh, there is a possibility of pulmonary hypertension. If you cannot, patient presents to you for the first time, you've taken X-ray, ECG probably, it may help you to suspect if it is primary pulmonary hypertension. So you have a 35 years old lady, non-smoker, no history of asthma, probably no occupational hazard, complains of some difficulty during her first pregnancy or delivery. And since there she's symptomatic, X-ray and ECG has been normal, probably you will have the suspicion of pulmonary hypertension in her. You would do echocardiography. I'm sure we have experts here. We have Ketan, we have Mangesh, we have Dr. Wander, we have Dr. Murugnathan. They all would know more about echocardiography than I, a chest physician, would know. But you could ask for echocardiography. You could even do transesophageal echo. You can even do exercise echo. And you would look at, probably raised right ventricular systolic pressure. And you would look at left-sided part. You may also look at if there are associated diseases where it may help you differentiate. It may tell you different etiology. There you may be some patient may be suffering from cardiomyopathy. You would then do VQ scan, but in today's time with easy availability of CT NGO and with better sensitivity of CT NGO, probably VQ scan is not preferred. We are managing with CT NGO, and you would pick up chronic pulmonary embolism there. You move the blue line further and you do spirometry. You may do ABG, that is lung function test, and you would be able to pick up gas exchange abnormality and ventilatory functional abnormality. In suspected cases, you may do polysomnography and pick up disordered sleep, disordered breathing, or obstructive sleep apnea, or maybe hypoventilation syndromes. You may ask for various other tests to rule out connective tissue disorders, and you may pick up scleroderma. And you know that almost 30% of the patients with scleroderma may have pulmonary hypertension is a presenting feature. You know, scleroderma may present a little later. You may have functional test to establish the baseline defect, and you may do finally the cath studies. Probably we would take up that during question and would ask Dr. Wander how to do and which kind of patients to do cath studies and what information we get. The best information we get is a vasodilatation test, and hence probably calcium channel blocker or no calcium channel blocker information we get it from there. So when on history and examination, when you have dyspnea, fatigue, angina, syncope, palpitation, edema, this is what you would do clinically. You may hear a loud P2. You may have a left parasternal heave. You may have a systolic murmur. There may be JVD with V waves. You may have hepatomegaly. There may be ascites. There may be a pulsatile liver. When you do X-ray and ECG, on ECG, you have a P pulmonale, which you can see in probably lead 2 or lead V1 here. You may have other features of cardiac abnormality patient has. On X-ray, probably you may see the peripheral hypovascularity, that means you see relatively black field. There is prominent central venous artery and probably RV enlargement. You may better pick up or better appreciate on lateral X-ray. So this is what you would pick up on ECG and X-ray. Echo, I'm not going to be talking about. There are special tests available on echo. VQ scan, I don't much do it. I would probably put more focus on pulmonary angiography, and there you would be able to pick up a small probably thrombus or a small infarct the patient has developed. And this is what is very easily seen. You can see a very big thrombus. You can see that yellow arrow, a very big thrombus in the main pulmonary artery just at the bifurcation. You may see pulmonary emboli, you may see lung infarct also with that, or there may not be lung infarct. Pulmonary angiography is required in a very small proportion of patients. There are parameters which would help you look at the prognosis. And if you look at the clinical evidences of RV failure, the rate of progression of symptom, if it is a rapid progression, if there is associated RV failure, if patient has got syncope, if patient has got functional class WHO of dyspnea more than 4, if his 6-minute walk test is less, proBNP is high, hemodynamics is showing probably RP of more than 15. If there is associated pericardial effusion, we are talking about a worse prognosis. But if you have probably see RV failure evidence is not there, if there is rate of progression is slow, there is no syncope, patient is able to walk for a longer distance, this patient will have a better prognosis. And this is when would you do follow-up investigation? Say you have diagnosed a patient of pulmonary hypertension, you have done the investigations, and then probably how soon would you repeat investigation? So probably once every 3 to 6 months, one has to do 6-minute walk test, the clinical assessment, and the proBNP levels. But probably if you offer them any treatment, and then after 3 to 4 months of the therapy, one must repeat the investigations and look at the improvement. And I would recommend one to do echocardiographies for sure. Whenever you initiate any treatment at the end of 3 to 4 months, look at symptomatic improvement, look at 6-minute walk test, if possible, do spirometry if required. And then echocardiography would tell you in very small proportion of patients, you may have to do CAT studies again to look at the improvement. And treatment goals are improving patient symptoms, enhancing functional capacity, preventing progression of disease, improving survival, improving hemodynamics, and the quality of life. The lifestyle modification, pregnancy is generally very poorly tolerated with pulmonary hypertension, and hence one must advise against pregnancy. Oral contraceptives, one has to be advising. And when you advise oral contraceptives, probably there may be issues with if patient is already on treatment, there could be drug-to-drug interaction, and one has to be careful about it. This patient cannot go to Himalayas. This patient cannot be climb mountains. There are issues with high altitudes, and hence one has to be careful. Air travel, one has to be cautious, though or long distance air travel could be a problem, but they have to take extra care. OTC decongestants may give you tachycardia and vasoconstrictions, and pulmonary hypertension patient, one has to be careful. Anemia needs to be treated very aggressively. These patients, if they are anemic, probably their prognosis is bad. We must offer them all possible adult vaccination. Standard treatment with diuretics, if patient has got associated failure, one may consider this. Calcium channel blocker, oxygen, oral anticoagulants, digoxin, and dobutamine are the standard treatments. So one would give diuretics only if patient has got associated right failure, if patient's proBNP is high. But in otherwise situation, it is not routinely recommended. Calcium channel blockers only minority would benefit. So whenever, if you have chance to do pulmonary CAT studies, and if your cardiologist, if Dr. Wander tells you, okay, yes, this patient is going to benefit, you may give them you know, calcium channel blockers like nifedipine or diltiazem. Depending on patient's heart rate, if patient's heart rate is low, you could give nifedipine. If patient has got associated tachycardia, you may be at advantage using diltiazem. Generally, the dose which is required to produce significant pulmonary vasodilatation or reduce pulmonary hypertension brings about systemic hypotension, and that is a limiting factor. So you are not at the limit; you don't get chance to prescribe higher dosage of probably calcium channel blockers. Oxygen, it is not again routinely recommended, but then if patient has got hypoxia at rest, or patient has got hypoxia on exertion, or if patient has got hypoxia at night during sleep, probably oxygen supplementation would help. Digitalis would probably, digoxin would help you increase cardiac output. And again, in small proportion of patient, it may be useful, especially patient has got associated stable atrial fibrillation, atrial flutter syndrome. Dobutamine, of course, would be useful only in hospital setting. Oral anticoagulation may have some rationale, probably because patient may have sedentary lifestyle, the life expectancy is bad, and probably they have a compromised pulmonary vasculature, bad. There is presence of probably prothrombotic stage, and yes, a lot of people prefer to put them on oral anticoagulation. With that, we talk about targeted therapy. So there are three major pathways by which pulmonary hypertension develops, and that is endothelin pathway, nitric oxide pathway, and prostacyclin pathway. And we have the endothelin receptor antagonist, we have bosentan, we have emrestatan, and then we have nitric oxide pathway, that is phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. We have sildenafil, and then we have two other drugs in the same group. And then prostacyclin pathway, you have prostacyclin derivative, that is epoprostenol, inhaled iloprost, and intravenous iloprost. None of the drugs of prostacyclin derivatives are available in India. So we don't have liberty to use any of this drug. But we have sildenafil, we have tadalafil. There are three drugs in the phosphodiesterase inhibitors group, and you have at least two drugs in the endothelin receptor antagonist group. And in fact, there is one more drug available, which is recently made available called Resiogut, which is mainly useful for group 4 pulmonary, chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. So this is an overview, though this slide looks very busy, but very simple. Just look at the red thing in center. You have to follow the general measures. Look at the right side. You avoid pregnancy, give them maximum possible immunization, subject them to rehabilitation, give them psychological support. You may prescribe diuretics, oxygen, oral anticoagulants, and you may give digoxin. So these are the general measures. You do expert referral. Here you would probably request your cardiologist colleague to have a look at this patient and look at the vasoreactivity test. That means subject them to cardiac cath and look at the vasoreactivity test. If it is vasoreactive and patient is in early phase, that is WHO functional class 1-3, you would offer them calcium channel blockers. As I said, probably nifedipine versus diltiazem can be used. And depending on if patient has improvement, you could continue calcium channel blocker. If patient doesn't improve, or if patient does not have vasoreactive test on cath positive, you can think about various other options. Various other options I spoke to you about, you have the options of endothelin receptor antagonist versus phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. So depending on the functional class, you look at the central box, you have recommendation, level of recommendation is there 1A, 2C, and you have functional class 2, 3, and 4. That means higher the class, you could give them both of the drugs of this class, that means you could use an endothelin receptor antagonist versus phosphodiesterase inhibitor. You have the functional class first, there's sildenafil. WHO functional class 3, you can use sildenafil. And in the class 4 also, you can use sildenafil. If there is inadequate clinical response, you go down and probably think about sequential therapy. That means you would change one molecule to the other molecule, or what you could do is you could combine the therapy, and there is the role of combination therapy. If patient does not respond well to this line of therapy, then there are surgical options available. One would do septectomy, or one would subject this patient to lung transplantation. So these are three different groups, I said. Prostacyclin analogs, endothelin 1 receptor antagonist, and in the bottom, you have phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. So prostacyclin, unluckily, is available. Not available, any of this drug is not available in our country, but if you look at epoprostenol, it is available only as IV. Prepoprostenol available only as injection. Iloprost is available only for IV and inhaled, and you may have to use it 6 to 9 times a day. The inhalation 6 to 9 times, which is not practical. You have beraprost, which is available orally active. QDA dosing that needs to be taken 4 times a day, again not available in our country. So we have endothelin 1 receptor antagonist, which acts by blocking endothelin receptors, and you have bosentan, emrisartan, and cetaxetan in this group. And then you have phosphodiesterase inhibitors, which acts by inhibiting phosphodiesterase E5 enzyme, which is orally active and safe. And it is most suitable for most of the patients with pulmonary arterial hypertension, easily available, cheap. And we have experience of using it for various other disorders. So this is orally active, potent phosphodiesterase E type 5. And this is how probably it works. It works by probably, you know, inhibiting the cyclic GMP degradation, and that brings about vasodilatation. The conventional dose is 20 milligrams 3 times a day, which can be increased to up to 240 milligrams a day. And there is hardly any side effect. In fact, I have been using this particular sildenafil for almost 10 years now, and I've hardly come across any side effect like headache, blurring of vision, and hypotension. But literature does mention that. I have not really crossed 120 milligrams a day dose, but literature mentions you could double the dose that what I'm using. That means I use generally 20 milligrams 3 times a day, 240 milligrams 3 times a day is what the dose that I use. And it is available as 20 milligrams strength now available with a different trade name, which is very important because, as you know, sildenafil is used for erectile dysfunctions also. And the dose which is used is about 100 milligram, 50 milligram to 100 milligrams. And here we are using 20 milligram strength. And this is the comparative study of various studies done and the end results and the disadvantages. And as I can, you know, see that you have endothelin receptor antagonists, phosphodiesterase inhibitors, prostacycline analogs. And if you look at the last column, the disadvantages, you have hepatotoxicity and headache and flushing, and prostacycline needs to be given, you know, injectable and 6 to 9 times a day, etc. Makes probably, you know, the endothelin receptor antagonist and phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors as a drug of choice. Combination therapy. More than 50% of the patients reach current treatment goals at the 1 year. And a lot of patients would respond to monotherapy. And there are some studies which say that probably addition of, you know, drugs like bosentan, etc. did not really bring about improvement in patients who were already on sildenafil. There are some studies which say that yes, probably, you know, some group of drugs, if added to sildenafil, can bring about improvement. I would say that initial trial of 40 milligram 3 times a day, if it does not bring about improvement, there may be some sense in looking at combination therapy. Balloon septostomy is one option where you would probably create artificial septal defect, atrial septal defect, and allow blood from right side to go to left side and hence reduce the pulmonary hypertension. Or lung transplant is a possibility now, and one could think of subjecting their patients to lung transplantation. And this is my, you know, final two or three slides, which talks about how do you initiate treatment. So you would look at supportive therapy and general measures. We spoke about oral anticoagulants, diuretics, oxygen, digoxin, and rehabilitation. Avoid excessive physical exertion, complete no to pregnancy, psychological and social support, and the infection prevention by influenza and pneumococcal vaccine. Then you would refer them for vasoreactivity test. If patient has got vasoreactivity, you would subject this, you would put these patients on calcium channel blockers. If there is sustained response, you would continue the calcium channel blocker. If there is inadequate response to this clinically, or if patient is a non-responder, depending on the WHO class, you would think about drugs, and probably sildenafil can be used across the class 2 to class 4. In situations, you may also think about adding other drugs like emrisartan, bosentan, or even tadalafil is available. Sequential combination therapy would be another option where if patient does not respond, you could do that. And if not, you would probably subject them to septostomy or the lung transplantation. In summary, I would tell you, keep very high index of suspicion when it comes to pulmonary hypertension. Order echocardiography wisely. Use targeted therapies as they are available now. Do consider cost, side effects, and availability of drugs. Also, drug-to-drug interaction in mind when you prescribe therapy to them. Be careful on misuse of calcium channel blockers. Calcium channel blockers can lead to systemic hypotension. And do consider lung transplantation as it is possible now. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, Agam. That was wonderful. And as usual, it was so lucid and, you know, you covered almost everything. Now, friends, we still have time of around 10 minutes for the Prime Minister's address. So till the time, we'll ask the President of Academy, Dr. Ketan Mehta, to start his case-based approach. He has very interesting cases. And along with him, to join and to guide us, I would introduce you to Professor Dr. Gurpreet Wander from Ludhiana. Dr. Wander, sir, I call him sir, I would say, because he is truly the doyens of cardiology, teachers of teachers, one of the most acclaimed cardiologists, winner of various accolades, president of Association of Physicians of India. He's been president of Cardiology Society. He's been academically active, one of the teachers, those who have taught us not only medicine or cardiology, but as a human being, he is one of the best ones from whom you should copy a page from his life, and you'll realize that Dr. Wander is a way forward for all of us to look for. So I have an extreme honor and pleasure to present to you Dr. Gurpreet Singh Wander, along with Dr. Ketan Mehta, President of Academy. Not only that, Ketan is also a Vice President of IMA Mumbai West Branch. Also, Ketan is a Secretary of Electrophysiology Society of India. I would request Dr. Wander also to bless the Academy and to guide us. And I'll also hand to ask Ketan to say a few words about Dr. Wander. Over to Dr. Ketan, please.
I want to probably interfere in between.
Yes.
I want to talk about Dr. Wander's amazing organizing capacity. I witnessed the Epicon that Dr. Wander probably hosted at Ludhiana. Yes. And it was one of the fantastic conference from scientific point of view and from organization point of view. I cannot imagine. Sir actually created a bridge between two places. There was a big road in between, and he actually created a walkover bridge, and that was something amazing. And the kind of feast we had for those 5 days of Ludhiana conference experience is still so live in my mind. Thank you very much, sir, for all those love, for all those blessings, for so many years that you've had on us. A big thanks to you from Academy and from my personal note. Get over to you.
Really touched.
Thank you, Mangesh. And I would like to definitely thank Dr. Muruganathan and Dr. Wander for joining with us. And I will definitely endorse whatever the Mangesh and Agam has said. We have witnessed the capability of both of these past presidents, and when they have organized, I would put it on record in Ludhiana to have Epicon, and in Coimbatore, Dr. Muruganathan had done it, which was wonderful. So salute to both of you, sir. Since we have some time, we will go with a few cases. And what we will do is we'll try to figure out interesting cases. Probably we'll able to take one case.
Ketan, sorry to interrupt, Ketan. I would request you to ask Professor Dr. Wander, sir, to say a few words of blessings to us.
Yeah, sure. So Dr. Wander, sir, can start with some few his blessings for the today's seminar, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Mangesh Tiwaskar, Dr. Agam Vora, and Dr. Ketan Mehta for these lovely, loving words from younger brothers. And thank you, Dr. Muruganathan, for the beautiful introduction to this CME. I must say, Agam's address was very, very appropriate and very informative from all aspects. And he has really created the scenario for Dr. Ketan Mehta to discuss some cases. The reason pulmonary artery hypertension is very important is because it is often missed. And as he also said in his presentation, it's the idiopathic pulmonary hypertension, which is actually the commonest cause of the pulmonary artery hypertension. And these young women at times, one has seen they come to the clinics of doctors and they are misdiagnosed as functional patients because the physical signs are at times subtle. So before we label a person as anxiety, hyperpnea or hyperventilation syndrome, we must do a good clinical examination and have a suspicion for pulmonary artery hypertension. Second important thing before Ketan says, I'll just take 2-3 minutes. It is, of course, a very frustrating disease to treat. Just as Agam said that there is a 40% of, survival at 4 years. This is the NIH data. So it is worse than actually even heart failure, and it is worse than most malignancies. So patients of primary pulmonary hypertension are to be taken very cautiously. And the best slide that Agam showed of all these, where we can make a difference to these people, is when he said avoid pregnancies, avoid going to high altitude, avoid oral contraceptives, because it's the maximum difference that you can make in their lives is by lifestyle alterations. And most of these drugs, of course, now they have come up and we use these drugs, in fact, very frequently. But what makes a bigger difference is these lifestyle changes, which we have to advise. So a long discussion with these patients to allay their anxiety and also to alter their lifestyle makes, like pregnancy is an absolute contraindication. And out of these various causes of pulmonary hypertension, of course, actually when we discuss pulmonary hypertension, our mind goes primarily to primary pulmonary hypertension only, because this is the Dana point or the WHO, the five types of pulmonary artery hypertension that Agam so nicely discussed. Out of the type 1 pulmonary artery hypertension, of course, we have various other causes like collagen vascular diseases, drugs can cause it, then cirrhosis, portal hypertension itself can have primary pulmonary hypertension. But it is the subset of patients who have collagen vascular disease and those which are HIV related. They have much worse prognosis than patients with primary pulmonary hypertension. And patients related to secondary to the congenital heart diseases, those patients who have Eisenmenger's complex, they have a better prognosis than patients of primary pulmonary hypertension. So it's not that all these patients behave similarly in terms of their prognosis. Patients of collagen vascular disease, patients of HIV related, they have much worse prognosis. And it's very important to distinguish patients of chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, that is the type 4 pulmonary artery hypertension, because the CTEP can at times mimic primary pulmonary hypertension, and it is a potentially treatable cause of pulmonary artery hypertension. So have a high index of suspicion, history of hypercoagulable state, history of use of excessive oral contraceptives, history of DVT in the legs. If these kind of histories are there, or there is a hypercoagulable state in the family, that the thrombophilias, in that situation, we must do a pulmonary CT angio, diagnose pulmonary thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. We know mortality of CTEP surgery is fairly high, but still it is one of the treatable causes. So we'll have some, we've had a beautiful talk. We will have discussion after Dr. Ketan Mehta's cases, but we'll also welcome questions from the audience, of course.
We already have almost 30-35 questions already been there, and they are still pouring in. So we'll have a genuine discussion afterwards. And I would also request Dr. Muruganathan to be there and be there as a panelist along with me, Dr. Ketan and Agam, to just complete the list of the experts to guide us as far as the pulmonary hypertension related questions are concerned. Yeah, over to you, Ketan.
Yeah, thank you, Mangesh. I must say that Dr. Agam has, in nutshell, has given a complete A to Z of pulmonary arterial hypertension. Probably just a bird's eye view completely covered it. Dr. Wander has given a beautiful tips on about it. So probably what we see that this entity just does not belong to one specialty, you know, be it internal medicine, be it a cardiologist, be it pulmonologist, be it rheumatologist, be it pediatrician, be it hematologist, and I would say in today's time, be it even obstetrician, surgeon, orthopedic surgeon, with the era so much of pulmonary embolism, we are seeing that we need to be really, really looking out for this entity. So everyone should have a definitely a high index of suspicion for keeping this pulmonary hypertension in mind, because we will see definitely in any specialty would see in day-to-day practice. So sir has really given us, highlighted us about all those various aspects and entities. I would be presenting, but probably we just left with two minutes only. So should we have Sameer, should we first have that, because probably we are just 2 minutes, 3 minutes before our honorable prime minister's speech, and by this time, obviously we are seeing that number of questions which are being getting bombarded, I'm sure, because it's a very interesting subject. As Dr. Murugnathan sir had said, it is also a neglected subject. People are not putting much stress upon it. It has been taken for granted. So many things which have evolved over a period of time. It's right from its diagnosis, right from its investigative modalities, and of course, the newer therapeutic modalities, which has also come. So probably we will go with obviously our Honorable Prime Minister's speech, and followed by we will take up the question answer session. Please stay with us, because on the same link, we will be going to have a live presentation from Honorable Prime Minister's office. So over to you, Sameer, for the further due for the presentations.
Thank you, Dr. Ketan. Mr. Jignesh, can you just start the live streaming, please?
We are just 2 minutes before 8 o'clock.
Dr. Wonder, sir, how often do we do this cath in pulmonary hypertension?
Cath is fraught with complications, because patients who have very severe pulmonary artery hypertension, the moment you take your catheter into the right ventricle, it is a very arrhythmogenic right ventricle. So doing catheterization has to be very cautious in patients of primary pulmonary hypertension. We do cath in patients where we are suspecting a secondary cause, like we are suspecting an Eisenmenger syndrome or an Eisenmenger complex. As far as the acute reversibility testing is concerned, very small subset of patients actually show reversibility with nitric oxide, which is very expensive, and most labs actually do not have nitric oxide. But there are some centers which do routine congenital heart surgery. They keep nitric oxide, because post-operatively it has to be used in patients where you operate with very high hypertension. Then you can use oxygen, you can use adenosine. There are agents which you can use for reversibility, but it is said that not more than 5 to 10% of people will show reversibility. So, I mean, in terms of effectiveness or benefits of doing a reversibility testing, it's not that useful. So centers would not be doing a cath, or satisfied with an echocardiogram, and as you rightly said, with a CT angio, you have ruled out the reversible causes. Right heart catheterization is not recommended to be done as a routine, and reversibility testing only yields benefits in not more than 5 to 10% of individuals. And calcium channel blockers, in fact, as a general rule, I would say for physicians, one should avoid using calcium blockers. Because, as you rightly said, we have very good two group of agents, the phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors and the endothelial receptor antagonists. Yes. And it has been shown that patients who are in WHO functional class 2 and 3, it's the combination actually of tadalafil and Embrisartan, which is the best combination. There was a trial which included about 500 patients by the name of Ambition trial. This particular trial has shown that tadalafil 40 milligrams in combination with Embrisartan 10 milligrams makes the best combination in patients who are functional class 2 and functional class 3. Patients who are in functional class 1, I think we are almost at the time. We'll carry on after this. They can be treated with single agents, but it's already my computer. Yeah, we can listen to the address and then we can come back.
No, whenever there is a PM sir's address started, you could just change the screen and put it on. Meanwhile, we'll continue discussion. Yes. Yes, sir.
Okay. So patients who are in functional class 1, and now what you showed very nicely, functional class 1 is patients in whom you diagnose pulmonary artery hypertension. Now, asymptomatic patients, some people would say, what is the need to treat? But the reason is it is a progressive disease.
So with this, I would hand over to Ketan for further proceedings. And thank you, everybody, for staying with us. Over to you, Ketan.
Yeah, thank you, Mangesh. So is the slides visible? Am I audible? Okay.
Yes.
So it was a really indeed a motivational and moral boosting speech by our Honorable Prime Minister. And of course, we are getting mentally prepared for the lockdown 4. So we'll come back to our initial discussions. So we will come to certain interesting cases in PAH. And I have curtailed because as Mangesh and Agam gave me a hint that there are number of questions which has come up. So I'm trying to reduce my cases also. Let's discuss certain interesting points in these cases. So let's look at this first case, a 68-year-old male who is a shopkeeper by occupation complains of shortness of breath since 4 days, grade 2 dyspnea, has a cough with sputum, pedal edema since 6 months, has a loss of appetite and generalized weakness. He's giving a history of hypertension since last 30 years. He has been diagnosed as COPD 5 years back. He has been a chronic smoker, smoking since 45 years, no significant family history. On examination, his pulse rate is 110 per minute, blood pressure 148 by 92 millimeters of mercury, respiratory rate 24 per minute. On RS examination, there is a bilateral wheeze which has been audible. And on CVS examination, there is a loud P2. So he is now complaints goes to a family physician who feels definitely he needs to be referred somewhere because he can't make out what is happening. So now we have a panel with a cardiologist, with a chest physician and an internist also. So where does this patient should be referred to which specialty? So I would ask Mangesh only, should he go to a cardiologist, go to a chest physician or an internist?
No, I intervene. It must go to chest physician. Okay. Because anyway, chest physician are jobless. Yeah. They must get some job. Cardiologists are too busy doing NGO.
Okay. So I'm sure the family physician really faces this situation because with a hypertension, with a diagnosed COPD and presenting with a breathlessness, which is a new onset. So obviously that confusion definitely remains. Fine. So we'll come to that. So which are the basic tests will you advise on a first consultation? So Agam or Mangesh can take that.
I think this patient, if I understood right, you said elderly patient with hypertension, a known COPD, with audible wheeze and loud P2. That means this patient is in acute exacerbation of chronic bronchitis. If patient is in acute exacerbation at this stage, I would recommend a blood evaluation, X-ray chest to look at a patch of consolidation, and whether it is pneumonic or non-pneumonic exacerbation of chronic bronchitis, that is all that I would want to know. I may ask for other tests like pro-BNP, etc. to understand, since you said there are bilateral edema feet, whether this patient is in pulmonary edema or core permanence issues like this. But at this stage, I would not ask for any further tests. I would treat the exacerbation because this is not the time to diagnose pulmonary hypertension. One would wait, let the exacerbation settle down, and once it settles, then I would carry out further investigation. Mangesh, you want to add something?
But Agam, I have a question here, you know, because there is a loud P2 which is there. Hmm. How often in a case of COPD, you encounter a loud P2? In fact, I would ask or request Wonder Sir to enlighten us on this. That how frequently you get an exacerbation of COPD with a loud P2?
Actually, Mangesh, you are right. Most patients of COPD will have hyperinflated lungs, and yes, it will be difficult for us to appreciate the loud P2 and left ventricle. Yes. So I fully agree with you. These kind of physical signs will be difficult to pick up. This patient has so as Agam was saying, I agree with him that we need to have a BNP level. And we also need to have actually maybe an echo at this stage, because we need to know whether this patient has a core pulmonale or a heart failure with normal ejection fraction, or I mean, what the LV functions are like. But in all probability, since there is an audible wheeze, patient is a known COPD, patient is a 68-year person. So COPD is very high on cards, but these elderly people can put surprises to you. So of course, we will like to treat the pulmonary condition, but we will certainly like to rule out actually a chest infection or a chest disease which could result in a core pulmonale or a LV dysfunction.
Okay, so obviously,
my question is this: that how about a baseline ECG, sir?
Yeah, we are coming to that. So we are coming to that. So this was the preliminary data, the investigations which were done, which shows only there was a definitely elevated WBC count. So what Dr. Agam was thinking would be a acute infective exacerbation, right? There was a mild anemia, hemoglobin of 11. Other metabolic parameters were normal. And this was the ECG, which was done at that particular time. So Dr. Wander can throw some light on this ECG, sir.
Yeah, this is actually very nice ECG, which does show us actually that there is a, if you notice in lead 2, there is a P pulmonale. So if you look at the lead 2, the P wave is spiky, tall, more than half square. You will call it as a P pulmonale. So there is a right atrial enlargement. There isn't much of right axis deviation. And because of the COPD, possibly this patient has a poor progression of R wave, which is pretty common in patients with chronic obstructive airway disease. So I would say this, the most prominent feature in this particular ECG is the P pulmonale that we have.
Correct. So obviously that would suspect when the patient has already developed a P pulmonale, and though it could be an acute infective exacerbation, but probably underlying pulmonary hypertension cannot be ruled out in these patients, which is there. So obviously, as suggested, the 2D echo which was done and which showed that there was a, obviously, tricuspid regurgitation was there, and there was a dilatation of right ventricle which was observed over here on a 2D echo. So 2D echo, this was the 2D echo report, which shows a good LV systolic function, obviously grade 2 diastolic dysfunction. There was a RV dysfunction which was seen with severe TR and moderate PAH with PA systolic pressure of 65 with dilated RA and RV. So Dr.
Mehta, your beautiful case which Dr. Ketan Mehta has first brought out for you, and this shows to all of us that this is in the classification that Dr. Agam Vora showed. This is the type 3 pulmonary artery hypertension. To recollect, type 1 is pulmonary artery hypertension, in which we include primary pulmonary hypertension, veno-occlusive, connective tissue. 2 is left heart failure. 3 is due to pulmonary disease. 4 is due to chronic thromboembolic. And 5 is the miscellaneous. So this is a beautiful... And actually, the reason he has shown this is because this is the commonest variety of pulmonary artery hypertension also, because this is the commonest cause. So must rule out these more common things first and then go to the uncommon things.
Sir, my point of question would be, will it be still justified asking in this patient NT-proBNP, or we will not do at this 2D echo report?
With this echo, there is no need actually, because BNP is a non-specific marker. It will be raised in, as you are trying to hint very rightly, it will be raised in even COPD patients where the RAR, it is a response to the dilatation of the atria. So you will have raised BNP, and it's not going to significantly add to our, once you see that the LV functions are normal, you have severe TR, you have pulmonary artery, and this much marked pulmonary artery hypertension will not usually be a feature of HFNEF. HFNEF will have moderate pulmonary artery hypertension. And how we grade pulmonary artery hypertension on an echo is, any pressure, mean pulmonary artery pressure of more than 25 is pulmonary artery hypertension. You add 15 to this mean pressure to go from mild to moderate to severe. So up to 40 is actually mild, 40 to 55 is moderate, and a mean pulmonary artery pressure beyond 55 is severe pulmonary. So this particular patient has actually very severe pulmonary artery hypertension. Severe
pulmonary.
Okay. So, Ketan, I want to ask, sir, another question. Sir, how common do you see this kind of pulmonary hypertension in COPD? Because in COPD patients, they generally have only mild pulmonary hypertension. So whenever I see moderate to severe pulmonary hypertension in COPD, I would always think of another possibility along with it. I don't generally pay much attention to this pulmonary hypertension in acute setting. I would want to stabilize this patient's acute exacerbation and then probably ask for a repeat echo. If repeat echo is also showing severe pulmonary hypertension, then it is not COPD related pulmonary hypertension. Patient has associated thromboembolic disorder for sure.
That's a very good point actually that you are making. Basically, you see, when does the pulmonary artery hypertension become severe? Whenever the pulmonary artery hypertension is coming up slowly. Whenever the pulmonary artery hypertension is coming up acutely, the RV will fail at pressures beyond 50 or so, and so you will not have very high PA pressures. So highest PA pressures you are going to find in primary pulmonary hypertension or in patients with Eisenmenger syndrome. The next highest you will find in COPD, because COPD is also a chronic disease and it's a gradually oncoming, but not such high blood pressure, pulmonary artery pressures as you will find in CTEP or in Eisenmenger's or in primary pulmonary hypertension. So what Agam is trying to say is, unusually high pressures, if you find, suspect an additional factor, but PA pressures will be high only if it is a chronically coming up cause of pulmonary artery hypertension, like in patients of Eisenmenger's, patients of primary pulmonary hypertension. Even in pulmonary thromboembolism, you would notice that in patients of acute pulmonary thromboembolism, you don't have high PA pressures, because it's the acute overload which pushes these patients into a right heart failure. So they have an acute corpulmonary kind of a situation where PA pressures do not. But COPD is a situation which is in between these. Since it is a chronic disorder, you can have moderate to high pressures in COPD also.
Ketan, over to you, Ketan.
I think something wrong with his...
I think he is stuck up. So, you know, his question, I will continue, sir. Yeah. You know, whether should we go ahead and what should be the further investigation in these patients? You know, whether
Can I take it?
Yes, that is for you only, sir.
Yeah. So I would say coronary angio is out of question, because what we have here is a corpulmonale, as Agam is saying. So we don't need actually, and there is possibly some chest infection over at it because the counts are also high. So at this stage, I don't know whether Agam would want a HRCT or not, but certainly an angiogram from my side is out of question at this stage. Agam can take.
Sir, give an opportunity for people to CT with pulmonary angio. CT is required because patient has got acute exacerbation of chronic bronchitis. The exacerbation, many a times you may find normal XHS, but may have a consolidation there on CT scan. And this would help you because pneumonia treatment and AACB treatment protocols are different. One would want to understand what is the underlying lung. And if given opportunity, I would do pulmonary angio at the same time, provided patients creatinine and rest of the reports are permissible, allowing us to do that. Yes.
Additionally, shall we go for the indirect markers of thromboembolism, pulmonary thromboembolism, like D-dimer or something like that?
D-dimer is a marker of thrombosis, but it's a very non-specific marker. And as a clinical diagnosis, we do not give too much value to D-dimer in such an acute situation. I would say, in fact, the maximum value respect D-dimer as a test has got is during COVID time today, because we are seeing that patients with COVID, they have high ferritin levels, high D-dimer levels, and lymphopenia. These are some of the things which are actually indirect markers of, we are using as indirect markers of COVID-19 if somebody presents with. But otherwise, to use D-dimer at this stage, it's not going to make a difference in terms of our, I would say, rather an example of this patient. But overall, the story to me doesn't look like a pulmonary thromboembolism. It's more of a, actually, it's more of a COPD kind of a chronic patient, long-standing history. But yes, chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension is a treatable condition. It's a condition which will have different kind of connotations. So it will be kept in the back of your mind.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Now, till the time Ketan joins, probably we'll take some questions from the audience. And there are a lot of questions which are flowing. So let me take the first question. Dr. Sumit from Chennai, he wants to know that are there any drug adjustments or dose adjustments of sildenafil in the elderly people when you manage pulmonary hypertension in patients?
Actually,
pulmonary arterial hypertension in patients.
Can I take it or can I take
it? Yeah, for you, sir.
Okay. See, sildenafil is a very good drug. And as Agam rightly pointed out, the dosages to be used, actually, it has to be used 3 times a day. So whenever you are using sildenafil for pulmonary artery hypertension, in a very large trial, Super 1 trial, it was shown that when you go up from 20 to 40 to 80, he showed us that we can go up to 240 milligrams. Which would be actually 80 milligrams 3 times. In that trial, 3 particular dosages were looked at. And as you go up in terms of dosage increase, their tolerance becomes minimal. Some of these patients will have hypotension. Some of them will have hot flushes, dry mouth. So the dictum today is actually to combine pulmonary artery hypertension drugs, to combine an endothelin receptor antagonist with tadalafil, because bosentan and sildenafil combination, when it was used, it showed that bosentan reduces the levels of sildenafil. So bosentan and sildenafil, which are the first line drugs out of the two groups, that doesn't form a good combination. And the best combination is actually tadalafil with ambisartan. So routinely, as Agam said, I would go 100% with him. My routine dose in these patients is 20 milligrams 8 hourly. And sometimes it's actually like systemic hypertension. Rather than going adding the dose of a drug, you add drug which has an act on a different site. So a combination therapy.
But
is
we don't require any dose.
Sorry?
I'm sorry to interrupt. Do you really require any dose adjustments depending on the age of the patient?
Age, the only side effect is hypotension, flushes. It does reduce systolic blood pressure also. In fact, people have tried sildenafil. They thought maybe it helps in heart failure also, but that was a negative trial actually. So it will reduce. If you will go very high on dosages of sildenafil, blood pressures will, and in such a patient who has a core pulmonale, see, basically pulmonary artery hypertension is a fixed cardiac output state. It's akin to actually these people, when they become active, they cannot augment their cardiac outputs. So whenever you will use vasodilators in a high dose in these people can have postural hypotension, So the tolerance will become an issue. So I would say end up this question by same what Agam said. 20 milligram TDS is a good dose. If you really want to increase good higher, dose. Go up to 40 TDS. Do not go to the 80 TDS dose. And actually, if you look at the graphs in this super trial also, there it doesn't result in any significant reduction in pulmonary artery pressures further.
Now, Agam, you talked about not using oral contraceptive pills, especially in the patient, those who have established pulmonary artery. What should be the reason for this? And which oral contraceptive pills you would not recommend?
In fact, as a rule, they should not be using any oral contraceptive pills. because it has a drug interaction with phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. So whenever you're using, most of your patients are going to be on phosphodiesterase inhibitor. That means one of those, sildenafilir, tadalafilir, one of those molecules, and it has a drug-to-drug interaction. So they should not be using any, they should adopt to alternative uses of, alternative methods of contraception.
Sir, there is a question from Pune.
Are pro-coagulant drugs, and on the one side we are saying we should use anticoagulant. So anything that is pro-coagulant should obviously be contraindicated in a patient with
coagulant. Yes, thank you, sir. And there is a question from Pune, and he is Dr. Karan, and he wants to know in which WHO functional class of the patient you would use sildenafil 20 milligrams. In which class? So, yes, sir or Agam, anyway.
In all functional classes, you could use sildenafil. In fact, in my opinion, phosphodiesterase 5 should be the first line drug because it is cheap, easily available, and probably, you know, you have little flexibility of playing with dose, because if you can go high on dose, it doesn't really add to too much of cost. You don't need to monitor liver function test, etc., which you may have to do with, rest of the drugs. If you're using emrisartan or, other molecules, it may be advisable to do liver function test regularly. Here with, sildenafil, you don't need a particular monitoring of blood levels for routine monitoring of, any of the liver functions, etc. So, to begin with, one must generally start with, or the way I do it, I would start with sildenafil 20 milligram 3 times a day. I would observe this patient for some time. I would repeat their evaluation. If there is clinical improvement, if there is improvement in 6-minute walk test, and as I routinely do, maybe 6 months down the line when I repeat their echo, and if I find that patient is stable, I would continue the same dose. If I feel patient is not fine, patient's symptoms are not under control, or if there is no improvement in pulmonary artery pressure on a repeat good echo, then I would think of two options. One, I would change the molecule, or I would add on the molecule. Current practice is not to change. Current practice is to add on, and particularly give them a combination therapy.
Yeah. Anything to add on, Jason?
No, I agree with him. Actually, the functional class 1, you give single agent, preferably sildenafil, because as Agam said, cheaper than endothelin receptor antagonists. And functional class 2 and functional class 3, you use a combination of endothelin receptor antagonist and a phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor.
There is a question which has come, sir, that Dr. Sumita from Kochi, she wants to know that once you get down on your pulmonary hypertension parameters, once they're controlled, can we stop sildenafil actually? Or how long to continue sildenafil?
As you had Agam had shown actually in the NIH trial, the mortality is very high in primary pulmonary hypertension. It's worse in connective tissue disease, HIV related. So drugs have to be continued for long term. Initially, there was actually most of the studies, as Agam was showing, were going, I think we've joined with Ketan. So we'll just finish with this question and then he can. Yes. Initial studies showed that they make a functional improvement. They make an improvement in their 6-minute walk test, echocardiographic blood pressure reductions, but mortality reduction was not there. But recently, actually, there was this ambition trial which showed a combination of this tadalafil and ambisartan. There's a reduction in mortality, especially as Dr. Agam said, in patients of chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, although the treatment is pulmonary endarterectomy, which carries a high mortality of 25% to 30%, but still these patients should be given in a good center where pulmonary endarterectomy is done, because that's the treatment of choice. Till that time, as he was showing, actually the guanylate cyclase stimulant, riociguat, is the drug of choice which is to be preferred. It is used in a dosage of 2.5 milligram 3 times. So it's a drug which is preferred in CTEP patients. But of course, as he said, the treatment of choice in these people is a pulmonary endarterectomy.
Hello. Yeah, Dr. Muruganathan wants to say, welcome back, sir.
No, it is a night time. Very interesting question. So much of a dose of sildenafil or tadalafil, will they have a sexual life, nice life, sexual life?
Interesting question. Very interesting question.
Because you are giving so much of... See, normally 20 milligram, 40 milligram, people sexuality says very good. Wander says 240 milligram. What will happen to that person? And especially when he knows he's going to die, he will have more enjoyment, no?
See, these sexologists, they use a nighttime evening dose of a higher dosage. We are using, as we just said, actually, these patients of pulmonary artery hypertension, you have to be cautious. You have to maintain, monitor their blood pressure, their postural hypotension. Penile erection is one of the side effects, just as menstrual. Actually, pulmonary artery hypertension is a disease more often in women, actually. 2 to 3 times more common in women than in. And it's the disease which occurs in the second and third decade more often. So more of these patients, you will be having women only rather than men.
So women also, it can increase the sexual feeling, right?
I don't think it causes sexual feeling.
No,
but
it doesn't increase it. Drive. Yeah. It actually increases the circulation in the penis and makes probably, you know, priapism or kind of, you know, I don't know the right terminology, but those erectile dysfunction probably part is taken care of. I think we have Samir here. Dr. Samir Muchala may be able to throw some more light on it. What we did is we did some literature search, but we did not find any cases of priapism or any cases of erectile, probably hyper erectile state or whatever with the dosages that we are using, because we are using anyway 3 times a day dosages. Samir, would you add on something?
Yeah, even the US FDA approved prescribing information of Revascio, which is the innovator brand, it says that there is a very rare possibility of priapism with 20 milligram twice daily of sildenafil. The European regulatory prescribing information does not mention about erection problem with 20 milligram thrice daily. And the only thing what caution they suggest is if there is any abnormal penile curvature or a patient with Peyronie's disease, then you have to be careful when you give sildenafil 20 milligram thrice daily.
Sir, I had a WhatsApp joke some time back, and he says, when you take this dose, probably you can pee better. You may not wet your clothes, you know, at night. So probably a lot of elderly patients find this dose very convenient. So that urinary flow is better.
Priapism, it is said that when a patient comes to you with priapism, you should first, of course, suspect misuse and all that. But malignancy should be kept in mind because some of these people with vascular malignancies, they can have hematological malignancies, they can present for the first time with priapism.
Correct.
And what about arrhythmia?
Meanwhile, start your share screen. Yes, sir. Dr. Murugan. Yeah,
what about arrhythmia? What about arrhythmia and pulmonary hypertension? Arrhythmias?
Arrhythmias are an issue in pulmonary hypertension, but generally atrial arrhythmias. Heart failure also occurs, but by the time patients develop pericardial effusion, patients develop right heart failure in a primary pulmonary hypertension, those, as Agam was showing, rise in BNP levels, these are markers of very bad prognosis. At that stage, these patients actually live for a very short time.
Okay. And what is diastolic pressure difference?
Diastolic pressure difference means?
What is it? They say before you do transplant, you assess the diastolic pressure difference, and they say QRS gating is the novel method to find out, because this is a diastolic pressure difference minus pulmonary artery wedge pressure. They calculate and then, you know, they do some work, and that is called QRS gating.
I will not be able to answer this.
Okay.
Okay, Kedar, you can load your slides.
Sorry, I because of connectivity, I was probably away from the stalwarts for 240 seconds. So I am.
It's okay. You went for your kitchen duty. Did you go to kitchen to help Purnima?
No. So now we will come back to a few questions. Probably I will directly jump to the very interesting next question, case presentation.
And what about artificial intelligence? Wonder, artificial intelligence?
Artificial intelligence in?
Yeah, in the, now they say the biomarker, they are trying to find out a biomarker, non-invasive biomarker to find out early and also for prognosis. Same way, they are using, right, they are trying to use artificial intelligence, you know, for controlling this hypertension.
I think they must be using, artificial intelligence, what it does is you feed lot of parameters and then prognosticate. So they must be entering all these BNP levels, 6-minute walk test, all these known factors which alter the prognosis and then thus for a given patient to see how good or how bad the prognosis is.
And what is the cause for pulmonary hypertension in HIV?
Unknown. So we don't know the cause, but it is a very frequent association that we found with this.
90% of HIV patients have pulmonary hypertension.
HIV, yes. I don't know what the cause is, but it's actually a kind of pulmonary hypertension where the prognosis is distinctly worse than patients of primary pulmonary hypertension.
So we don't know with connective tissue disorders like the scleroderma. It is the association. So you found about 30-40% of patients scleroderma will have pulmonary hypertension, pulmonary arterial hypertension. So there, and HIV also, it is association. In certain patients, we found they have it, and the mortality is very high in them.
So Mangesh, you will have to, because since I had missed a couple of minutes, so probably some questions which has been discussed, you can tell me, then we will proceed further.
Okay.
Now, this is another interesting case. 37-year-old housemaid admitted to the hospital with complaints of breathlessness since 5 months, which will gradually progress to grade 3, swelling of legs since 2 months, which was insidious, gradually progressive, abdominal distension since 1 month, and there is a history of reduced urine output. Now, these are all very important points. There is no history of chest pain, palpitation, altered sensorium, facial puffiness, fever, high colored urine, abdominal pain, vomiting or loose stools or hiccups. There is no history of oral ulcers, alopecia, photosensitivity, arthralgia, skin pigmentation, Raynaud's phenomena, dysphagia, skin tightening, intolerance to cold, or even altered bowel habits. Because all these negative history is very, very crucial when we are evaluating such patients. Okay, now in a past history of no similar illness in the past, not a known case of diabetes, hypertension, coronary artery disease, bronchial asthma. Personal history wise, she takes a mixed diet, not an alcoholic or a smoker, no history of substance abuse. Marital history, married with 2 children, antenatal history, uneventful, no history of promiscuous sexual activity, regular menses. On examination, patient conscious, oriented, afebrile, hydration status fair, muddy conjunctiva. There was a grade 1 clubbing with bilateral pitting edema fit, but no pallor, cyanosis or lymphadenopathy. JVP was elevated, A and V waves prominent, pulse rate of 80 per minute regular, blood pressure 110-70. On CVS examination, Dr. Muruganathan was mentioning about typical findings. He or she had an apical impulse in the left fifth intercostal space, 2.5 centimeter lateral to midclavicular line, normal character, grade 3 parasternal heave, palpable P2, in tricuspid area, there was a pansystolic murmur, grade 3/6. In pulmonary area, there was a loud P2 with ejection systolic murmur, grade 2/6. Other system examination, respiratory system normal, per abdomen, liver palpable 2 centimeter below the free fluid was present, no splenomegaly, bowel sounds normal, CNS, no focal deficits. So obviously impression over clinically was that there was a pulmonary hypertension with right ventricular failure. So I would ask the panelist, everybody agrees or there is any one who disagrees to this diagnosis and what they think could be the cause of it. Dr. Muruganathan, sir.
Probably relatively young patient, early female patient, 30s, 40s, and presenting like this. I would keep possibility of underlying lung disease, underlying heart disease, and probably other system. So probably I would think in terms of interstitial lung disease, or maybe, thromboembolic disease, maybe cardiomyopathies, etc., or maybe liver cirrhosis or something like that. But with whatever presentation you said, I think most of the things are ruled out. So we are talking about what primary.
Okay, so now obviously you started with the test. So the basic lab test, which you'll do to rule out first, obviously secondary causes of pulmonary arterial hypertension. And this was the labs which were available. urine negative, nothing positive. Random sugar was normal. RFT urea 15, creat of 0.8. CBC, there was a mild anemia which was there, nothing significant. LFT, there was a hypoproteinemia with hypoalbuminemia, proteins of 5.6 and albumin 3. Rest of the parameters were normal in LFT. Coming to peripheral smears, it was a microcytic hypochromic anemia was there. Coagulation profile was normal, BT, CT, PT, INR, APTT, everything was normal. Further tests which were done, serostate negative, RF factor negative, thyroid function test, free T3, free T4, TSH, everything was normal. Obviously, as we have discussed, so complete what Agam wanted, that collagen workup was done. So ANA was negative, DS DNA antibody negative, scleroderma 70 antibody negative, SM antibody was also negative. Obviously, Agam would always go for further. Even in this lady, Mantoux was done negative, sputum negative, sputum AFP negative, cultures was again negative for pathogens. And sonography of abdomen was also a bang normal study. So this was the primary workup done. And this was the ECG. Again, doctor, I would request Dr. Wander to focus, probably it's cut. So ECG, obviously it is showing, as discussed earlier, we have P pulmonale with right atrial enlargement, which is quite evident over here.
And there is right axis deviation also.
Right, sir. So that was absolutely visible over here. And echo confirmed RARV dilated with moderate PR with severe pulmonary hypertension with PA systolic pressure of 85. Okay. Now, this was the chest X-ray, cardiomegaly, and what Agam had very nicely shown over here, that there is a peripheral pruning which is seen over here. So my question now will start in evaluation point of view. Agam, what is the role of general role of X-ray chest in evaluation of pulmonary arterial hypertension?
It only helps you rule out other disease. So by and large, if you have other possibilities in mind, it will help you rule out those things. But yeah, X-ray chest is normal. And most of the times, you may not be easily picking up what you showed on your X-ray about the peripheral pruning and the prominent right heart. Probably those things are not very well. Those are not very well appreciated in most of the time. So X-ray is normal. You do X-ray chest mainly to rule out associated disease. You do mainly X-ray chest to find out if there are any complications of pulmonary hypertension, if it is a known case of pulmonary hypertension, like pleural effusion and failure, etc. Okay.
So can I just take half a minute? Agam said, X-ray, as he's rightly saying, is normal in people with pulmonary artery hypertension, because cardiomegaly is actually not a feature of primary pulmonary hypertension or even Eisenmenger's. Out of the three Eisenmenger's between ASD, VSD and PDA, it is the patients of ASD where you can have relatively the heart size might be a little bit bigger. But routine patients of Eisenmenger, patients of primary pulmonary hypertension, they will have a normal sized heart. Finding of a cardiomegaly actually is a sinister sign in Eisenmenger or with patients of primary pulmonary hypertension. It could either be due to pericardial effusion or it could be due to a right heart failure, which is a very late stage and a terminal stage actually. But
right. So in fact, I completely agree to what Wander sir said, Ketan. Yes, sir. Continue. Wander sir, yes.
Yeah, fine. So can we can proceed further? So,
okay. Yeah. So now so
X-ray chest can be a negative diagnostic feature, in fact.
Correct. So basically,
we talk about the prognosis.
Correct. To rule out a parenchymal disease, if at all, then obviously next you will go for a PFT. So again, I will ask Agam, what is the role of PFT in evaluation of pulmonary arterial hypertension? Now, this was the PFT, which was the primary findings of this patient, where it was found there was a mild restriction, our subject patient. So there was a pattern of mild restriction. So what is the role of otherwise PFT? How does it will help for evaluation of PH?
PFT generally does not help in, again, making up your mind in terms of pulmonary hypertension as such, but then you have to manage patient overall. And hence you have to look at PFT to understand if he's got associated obstructive pattern or if he's got associated restrictive pattern. You may get some restrictive pattern with pulmonary arterial hypertension, but again, PFT is not going to be the choice of investigation in initial workup. I would prefer doing CT scan and CT angios before I consider him for PFT. I would do routine PFT in patients if I'm suspecting underlying COPD to understand the severity of obstruction and to design treatment of COPD. But if I'm not suspecting underlying COPD, I may actually skip doing PFT.
Okay, so it will be have a limited role. So obviously now, can you focus what can be the role of ABG in the evaluation of pulmonary arterial hypertension?
Again, it is one of the lung functions. So it will tell you about the ventilation status of a patient. So by and large, if your patient has got hypoxia or patient has got high carbon dioxide, that is hypercapnia. So one of the causes of pulmonary hypertension is hypercapnia or alveolar hypoventilation syndromes. So if you have a type 2 respiratory failure, obviously with normal pH, you may keep alveolar hypoventilations as one of the possibilities, and hypoventilation, you may do even neurology workup if otherwise a patient is fitting into that. But otherwise, arterial blood gases may also be normal. If your patient's spirometry is normal, ABG is normal.
Okay.
Venous oxygen saturation, a low mixed venous oxygen saturation is a marker of bad prognosis in this. In fact, that might be more beneficial. If it is less than 60, it might be a marker of a low cardiac output state in these people.
Hmm.
So now, this was the arterial blood gas analysis of our patient. pH of 7.39, PaO2 of 92, PaCO2 of 41, and bicarb of 22. And as all of you have said, fairly normal ABG, which is there. Okay, so now comes here the question. What is the role of perfusion scan for the workup of pulmonary arterial hypertension?
Perfusion scan, the BQ scan is of course the gold standard. It is described in literature as one of the most important tests, but with advances in CT scan and with ultra-fast CT scans with good, CT angios available, I think it is replaced VQ scan. VQ scan is not easily available, and probably ultra CT angio is far more easily available. So I think protocols are now changing. I would ask for only CT angio in this situation. MRI only for understanding associated underlying valvular heart disease, which I am not picking up on echo. Or probably transesophageal echo is not possible. In those situations, one could think of doing MRI. But again, for MRI, most of these patients are too tachypneic to undergo MRI evaluation.
Okay. So I will ask Dr. Wander, sir, can this pulmonary CT angio replace completely the perfusion or VQ scan, sir?
You see, VQ scans are, as Agam was suggesting, they are costlier than CT angios, and they are less frequently available. We have VQ scan in our hospital. We will use it only when the patient's renal functions are deranged. Otherwise, actually, the investigation of choice is a CT angio only. And CT angio will actually show you not only, because it's not always that these pulmonary thromboemboli would be chronic. They can have an acute on a chronic. So sometimes you will find an acute on a CTEP situation where you will find a thrombus in the main pulmonary artery, and there will be in CTEP you will generally find thrombus in the distal pulmonary vasculature. So I would go fully with Agam that CT angio is actually the investigation of choice if you are suspecting CTEP for some reason actually.
Okay, so
they say for CTEPH. This perfusion scan is better. To exclude that, you have to do this.
Yeah, conventionally it has been said, sir, but you will pick up actually all this on a CT pulmonary angio. Practically, you will do a CT pulmonary angio.
Okay, so Agam, would you advise for going for a complete HRCT chest along with pulmonary CT angio, or would you ask only pulmonary CT angio?
Only you do CT angio if you're not suspecting underlying pulmonary disease. So if you're suspecting COPD, if you're suspecting interstitial lung disease, etc., you may do it. If I'm doing this CT angio and if I pick up there is esophageal dilatation, maybe I would ask for a complete scan. I would ask for CT chest as well. That means if I'm suspecting scleroderma and probably things like that. But otherwise, HRCT is not really required.
Okay, and is there any role of MRI chest?
MRI, not actually, you know, in this particular story that you have told till now, there is no real indication for a CT angiography, any of these, because you haven't given us any hint for a CTEP, actually. She's a young lady, and there is no history of DVT, no history in the past of any hypercoagulable state, oral contraceptive use. Post-pregnancy, anything of that sort would have happened, that she would have had a worsening after pregnancy. So some sort of that. But if you do a CT angio, I have no objections in doing a CT angio. But the yield is not going to be very high. If a patient is very obese, patient has history of, episodic worsening, patient has history of DVT, that kind of a situation, oral contraceptive use, where we are suspecting some reason for a pulmonary thromboembolism, their CT angio should be done. Every routine patient of PH, it will not really significantly add to the...
Okay, fine. So now this was the CT chest of the patient which was done. And findings, what was found was there was only RARV dilated with pulmonary artery dilated. There was a mild cardiomegaly and lung parenchyma was normal. So obviously the final diagnosis was idiopathic pulmonary hypertension. Well, the point is, now before you label somebody who has a idiopathic pulmonary hypertension, does in their case asking for a CT justify it?
Yes. It's a debatable issue. As I said, some people who are very aggressive, they might do a CT pulmonary angio. I do CT pulmonary angio for acute pulmonary thromboembolism, even if I have a low index of suspicion, because that's a more treatable condition. CTEP is less commonly you find it than you suspect it. But if there is any such marker that patient has a leg swelling, patient has oral contraceptives, patient has, you are suspecting some reason for a, or there are sudden cutoffs in the pulmonary vasculature that you are seeing, that kind of a situation, yes, there is no harm in doing, it's a non-invasive. And if the patient's creatinine is normal, renal functions are normal, there's no harm. Patient can afford it, you can do it also.
Fine.
Now, Ketan, in many a situation, a plain CT scan also, you can pick up, embolisms. So it is not that you need every time pulmonary angio only to pick up. If there are bigger, if there are subtle thrombosis, we are actually involving the major pulmonary trunks, it can be easily picked up on simple CT scan also. But yes, I would slightly differ from what sir said, because sir, I would want to do pulmonary angio to be extra sure of my diagnosis that it is only primary and not secondary. I would want to do it because now there are probably therapeutic options available where I may think about starting patient on risiogut directly if it is thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, and if it is not, then I would think of starting this patient on sildenafil. That's my take on doing this pulmonary angio.
Recently, Ketan.
As I said, pulmonary angio can be done easily, but it is fraught with complications. So before you embark upon, see, these people are very sick. These women with primary pulmonary hypertension, idiopathic, they're sicker than what you and I actually evaluate on the face of it. So I would not investigate these people unnecessarily unless I have a reason for index of suspicion, and I will stop short at a CT angio. I will not do a pulmonary invasive angiogram. I will do all that in patients in an acute pulmonary thromboembolism, because we have a protocol in our institution for acute and subacute pulmonary thromboembolism. We actually break we cause thrombolysis, and we mechanical lysis of the thrombus we are doing. And we've published extensively this work actually. And then we give lesional local thrombolytic agent over a period of time, which compares actually better than a systemic thrombolysis in patients of subacute, because the yield becomes greater, the thrombus lysis is greater in a subacute thrombus thromboembol. In a chronic situation, actually, what Agam said at that time, it's the lifestyle advice which makes a bigger difference to their, more often, not doing something is a more pertinent thing than doing something aggressively in these people.
Okay. So now quickly, I think treatment part, majority of them are covered, different types of drug therapies which are used. Mentioned ACCP guidelines, what are the different therapies which we know. Now, probably I think this all, Mangesh, as it has been discussed, what will be the choice of initiation with, whether it will be...
Actually, drugs have been discussed very nicely. If you go to the...
So we will go with move further. Now, sildenafil versus tadalafil, again, the data which is more for the sildenafil, since the super study which has shown good results in that. Okay, here I would have, is there a role, I mean, just Dr. Wander was just mentioning about giving a combination therapy. So which subset of patients would you go for a combination therapy using the both, for example, say sildenafil plus bosentan?
We've already discussed this actually. Sildenafil, bosentan is not a good combination. Good combination is tadalafil and ambrisartan, which is actually the treatment of choice today by the guidelines for class 2, class 3 people.
Okay. Sir, is there any
combination, Ketan? If patient is already on sildenafil, there is no added advantage of putting them on bosentan.
Correct.
So this study was, I mean, just for the benefit of audience. This is not.
And is there any role of antiplatelet agents and statins, Dr. Wander, please?
No role for antiplatelets, statins. And even in fact, if you will go 6-7 slides back, the one slide that you had shown, which discussed about the, if you will go back further, further back. Yeah, this one. Actually, most of these, you will find this to be discussed. Most of these agents have no role to play in patients of pulmonary artery hypertension. Digoxin is actually, Dr. Murugnathan was saying some time back, it is very arrhythmogenic. It can cause arrhythmias in these people. Diuretics only in low doses by the time patients develop right heart failure. And by the time they develop right heart failure, there are bad prognosis. CCBs don't help really. They only help in 5 to 7% of people. And they make, in fact, if you start using them in all the people, they make them worse. Domiciliary oxygen therapy has some role to play in people who have oxygen saturations of less than 88%. So if your patient is having, I could see there was a question.
Yeah.
So there is some role for domiciliary oxygen therapy as a frustrating kind of a late stage, because it will not harm these people. But most of these other therapies are to be used very sparingly.
So I think that is what which is there. Now, probably there is now, I don't know whether I missed on that, whether indications for lung transplants, whether which subset can we go for heart-lung transplant, both of them?
I'll just add a couple of things. I have no personal experience, but what I have heard of and what I have heard some speakers, lung transplant is a much worse end result than cardiac transplant. 5-year survival with heart transplant is to the tune of 80% in very good centers. But 5-year survival with a lung transplant is only 40%. So lung transplant carries a much worse prognosis. It gives very many more medical problems as compared to heart transplants. You all know heart transplant is now happening quite extensively in our country. There is only a single center in Madras which is doing lung transplants, and they too have done about 40-50 patients only. So lung transplant is a much more frustrating experience. There is a doctor in Punjab who had a lung transplant, who's actually is a friend of mine, his wife. That particular patient is doing very well, but mostly these patients don't do well on a long-term basis. But this is the only form of treatment in patients with terminal stage.
Correct. So I think we have touched upon everything. What we learn at the end is what we know. Don't know is an ocean, as said by Isaac Newton. So thank you so much, and sorry for the inconvenience. So we can take, if the time permits, Mangesh can take the questions subsequently.
Quickly take a couple of questions, and then we can end up. Probably we already overshot the time. And
regarding your topic, Agam, you said hidden enemy.
Pardon?
The topic was hidden enemy.
Yes, hidden enemy. Yeah.
So better to have an open enemy than hidden friends. My policy.
Yes.
Where will you face COVID-19, sir? Hidden or?
Yeah, now there is a question saying that, you know, are pulmonary arterial hypertension and venous hypertension are different entities? How do you differentiate, if at all? And what are the prognostic, you know, things that you will look into?
For that, you will need cardiac cath studies. You know, you will have to judge the capillary pressure, the wedge pressure. And depending on the wedge pressure, you can actually differentiate it with arterial and venous. Right, sir? Dr. Wonder?
Pulmonary venous hypertension is, see, whenever the type 2 that he said, whenever there is a left heart disease like mitral stenosis, aortic valve disease, cardiomyopathy, whenever there is a left heart disease which is causing right heart failure, there will be a raised pulmonary capillary wedge pressure as well as there will be raised pulmonary. So as Dr. Murugnathavan was saying, pre-capillary and post-capillary, the post-capillary variety will have high pulmonary artery wedge pressure, which is the LA pressure actually. If it is more than 14-15 millimeters of mercury, you say it is a post-capillary. But a pre-capillary, it will be that you have a normal pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. Even for measuring pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, you don't need to do the left heart cath. You do the right heart cath, okay, the Swan-Ganz catheter, inflate the balloon. And once you have inflated the balloon, the pressure that comes distally is from the pulmonary. It is a reflection of the pulmonary venous pressure. So whenever there is a high pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, which is equal to the LA pressure, it means it is a type 2. And so it's a totally different ball game. It is a cardiac failure. It is a failure due to HFNEF or mitral valve disease or anything, or a left heart disease, which is causing a pulmonary artery hypertension. But a pre, there is only one very, very rare kind of disease, what is called as pulmonary veno-occlusive disease, which is also a form of type 1 in that WHO or a Dana Point classification of pulmonary artery hypertension. It is again a pre-capillary type.
And the treatment is completely different. Because type 2, you don't have to treat at all.
Management plans will change.
Management of only underlying cardiac disorder. And in fact, sir, this cystosomiasis is also probably not taken into one, a group 1 disorder.
Nathan was asking.
Inclusive disorder actually due to cystosomiasis, but it is taken as class 1, that is arterial hypertension. Yes.
There is one more question. Where with sildenafil plus iluprost,
better
combination?
Yes.
You know, it's said to improve the 6-minute walk test. What is your take on this combination?
All these prostacyclin group drugs are not available in our country. You know, inhalation and parenteral use. Probably that too, inhalation you have to take 6 to 9 times a day, makes it almost non-practical. Though studies mention that combination has got advantages, I personally doubt. In fact, a lot of people tried stem cell therapy also in Gujarat. I think at least 10 patients whom I am aware underwent stem cell therapy with zero results.
Yeah, how about sildenafil in that super study again? The super study which was there, and use of sildenafil there. You know, it has also shown to be improving. So do you generally prescribe only monotherapies? And to which patients you will prescribe monotherapy, in which patients you will go for a combination therapy?
As sir said, probably all functional class, early class, you would start only with monotherapy. So if you have functional class 1, functional class 2, probably that time you would start only single therapy. Patients who are more symptomatic or patients whose pulmonary artery pressure are not settled with monotherapy, you would consider dual therapy. And as sir already said, probably if it is a higher functional class, you may take advantage of available literature and put them on combination therapy to begin with, because the life expectancy is low. Most of your patients, though literature say whatever, most of your patients you will lose in the next 5 years once you have a pulmonary hypertension.
So how much is the general 5-year survival rate in most of the patients?
5-year survival rate is less than 30%. So it's a very bad prognosis condition, actually. NIH graph that he showed, actually, I mean, at 4 years, only 40%, 39% people are living at 4 years. So it's a very, it's a disease in which prognostication is a very important part of. General advice to the patient about the disease, lifestyle, all these are very important, integral part of the whole that.
And absolute contraindications for sildenafil.
Pregnancy, primary pulmonary hypertension, pregnancy. For sildenafil, there isn't actually really much of an absolute contraindication. But if you will use it in lower dosages, it, if patient has syncope, if patient has hypotension, as I said, it's a fixed cardiac output. You further reduce their preload, their, they can have syncope. Then, of course, you will have to avoid it.
And also, the combination, if you have a nitrate drugs and sildenafil, combination of drugs sometimes will produce problems. So you must ask before you give sildenafil whether any interaction between the drugs. Right, Wanda, is it correct? Yes,
absolutely, sir. Absolutely.
Yeah. Now there is a question, Samir. If you can talk about COMPASS-2 trial, you know, and you have been working on that, and you know that then there was a question saying that, do you think adding bosentan again to sildenafil will be better? No, this has been already discussed, but there's
trial. Was the only trial which where the patients were either with sildenafil or the placebo arm, and then bosentan was added to the therapy. And what was shown that addition of bosentan to sildenafil did not have any further benefit to the patient. I mean, Dr. Wander can also add on to it, but this is what was the result of the COMPASS 2 study. Sildenafil monotherapy is good enough. Add-on bosentan really does not give any added benefit.
In fact, bosentan was also tried in systemic hypertension also. Then if that drug did not work.
Right.
Hey, Samir, what I want to understand from you is, why do we keep the same name as you have the drug for erectile dysfunction? You know, most of my patients find it very difficult. When you prescribe them, they go to chemist and the chemist probably tell them, hey, this is for you. Why have you given this? And then patients have problem. Patient's wife is a problem. You know, they feel that patient has spoken to them about sexual dysfunction, and without wife knowing it, you have given this prescription, and then wife would come and probably, you know, ask you why this drug was given.
To answer a much bigger problem that I face for the same name is, I prescribe ACE inhibitors to a patient of heart failure, and he goes to a chemist and he records his blood pressure to be normal, and he says, "Case ko band kar do, ye blood pressure ki, aapka blood pressure to normal hai." So that kind of problems today we face that, and you have to you have to take a while to tell that, make that patient realize. So possibly if there is an ACE inhibitor with a different name for a heart failure, then at least that chemist will not. He doesn't know that this particular drug is can be used for hypertension, for post MI patients, for heart failure. He, to his simple mind, blood pressure is normal. He says ki isko ab band kar sakte hain.
Preventive aspect is very important. Don't forget influenza vaccine and pneumococcal vaccine. Immunization is very important.
He said, sir, that's a, you are right, actually. Vaccination, Agam covered twice in his slides, but Dr. Murugnathan is actually an adult vaccination super specialist. Yeah. So it's a very, thank you very much. Any patient who is sick, these vaccinations, and who knows, after a year or so, we might say, you might sit here and say that coronavirus vaccine also.
Yeah.
Corona vaccine also is required. Yes. True.
Yeah. So, well, thank you very much, sir. These are all questions. I again put on the records my big thanks from the Academy to all the participants. Thank you very much, Murugnathan sir, Wander sir, Ketan, Agam, and Samir, and entire Zydus team for this entire venture. And the best to all the participants, those who are sustained. Now, sir, we are clocking almost 800 still online with us. Yeah. We have almost 2.5 hours spent together. Almost 800 people are there already logged in and listening to us. So thank you very much. We are honored. Once again, I'll tell you that the certificates will be delivered to you in your mailbox. You please go on and click in the link and fill in your correct names, and automatically you will get your certificates of participation within 2 working days. With this, I would ask
my appeal to all of you for the post-lockdown session. Please protect yourself before you protecting others. Follow the rules. Of course, hand washing and physical distancing. Advise your patients. So this is my appeal.
Yes.
Sir, will you give a take-home message, Dr. Wander?
Yes, take-home message, sir.
I think take-home message is you've done an excellent job and your talk was actually remarkable. The cases that Dr. Ketan gave
from you.
Very thought-provoking. And as usual, Mangesh is an excellent compere, and he organizes, gives chances to everybody. So that's why we are so fond of him. And the presence of Dr. Murugnathan has lent that flair and that class to this session. So thank you. It's been an honor, actually, and a pleasure for... thank you, Dr. Samir, for being and clarifying, and thank you, everybody.
Ketan,
thank you.
Message.
So the excellent only thing is it's a really a thought provoking, and the people should give a high index of suspicion and keeping their pulmonary hypertension as one of their differential whenever they are seeing a patient of unexplained breathlessness. So that should be kept. And I will be definitely thankful to Dr. Wander and Dr. Muruganathan for participating with us in the Academy of Advanced Medical Education program. And Mangesh had conducted fantastically as usual.
Cheers to Mangesh for doing it so well. Thank you everybody for your time. Corona namaste to everybody. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Just one information, below the comment box, we have a download certificate for the delegate. So they can download it from just below the message. There'll be a direct download of the certificate right now. It will be there.
Oh, great.
That was too much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Wanda,
sir.
Thank you, Dr. Murugan. Bye-bye. Good night, sir. Bye-bye. Good night. Stay safe. Stay healthy.